Welcome to Living Word Ministries with our director and Bible teacher, Debbie Blank. Debbie's passion is for you to understand and apply God's truths to your life. Now let's listen and enjoy teaching from the Word of God with Debbie Blank.
Let's invite the Lord to join us and to change us as we study His Word. Oh, Father, you do. You give us your word that is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and able to pierce the division of soul and spirit and joint and marrow, and able to discern the thoughts and intentions of our hearts. More importantly, God, even than that, is that you see us today for what we can become. You see us for what we are in our character and the potential that's there. And you want to use us for what you know we can do. And then, fortunately, you empower us. So, Father, that's the story of Gideon as we study today. I pray that you'll open our eyes to see how much we are like Gideon a lot of the times, but how Gideon grew as he walked with you, and that's what you want for us to. Open our eyes to what you would have us learn from you and your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, this is the third teaching I've done in the last week. Obviously, we got snowed in a little bit, but the third teaching, and it's fascinating because the theme for all three teachings has been God's calling. We taught Ezekiel a week ago, the first chapters, spectacular vision of God in heaven on a throne with these strange four living beings underneath the throne and all that was going on in this vision. Before God called him. Then we talked about, on Sunday night when I was teaching, we talked about Moses and his calling. Less spectacular than a vision, but still pretty spectacular, a burning bush. Now, Ezekiel was 30 years old. He was a priest, but he couldn't be a priest because the temple was gone. He was in exile. He was looking for what God was going to do with his life. Moses was just out shepherding flock. He was just doing what he normally does. But he saw something unique. Gideon. Gideon's not only being Gideon, but Gideon's fear is taking over from what he's doing when he receives a calling. Everybody's in a different point in life. But God calls us all to do his work. Sometimes it's pretty spectacular. Here is going to be the angel of the Lord appearing to Gideon. Sometimes it's just, you know, a friend of mine who had a state senator call her 20 years ago and say, we need your help down at the legislature. Would you come down and testify against a bill? And so she got a couple friends, never done it before in their lives, went down, testified, and won. You know, I mean, the issue never got out on the floor. And she thought, well, this is great, 3-month thing. Well, it's been 20 years now. And she's still fighting it, and the issue has still never come up. And it has come up many times in Nebraska, but we still are free from that particular vice. So that was a different call. God didn't call her. A friend called her. And that led her into what became God's calling in her life. So we don't know who God's going to use to call us or how he's going to call us. But he does call us for the things he wants us to do. So with that, let's turn to Judges chapter 6. And we're going to see today, as we first begin, how he calls Gideon. It says, then the sons of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord gave them in the hands of Midian 7 years. Do you see anything familiar in verse 1? Yes, they did evil in the sight of the Lord. I had told you when we first started class that there's a 7-cycle period in the book of Judges where they continually go through the cycle that we've discussed and go spiral downward. Well, these are the 7 places where it happens, and under 7 of the judges. It doesn't mention it with all of the 13 judges mentioned in Judges, but it does mention it here. Each time we see that the people did evil in the sight of the Lord, by the time they came back to fulfilling that cycle, they had gone down a notch from where they started. So I'll leave that up there for a minute so you can all see it. Now it says in verse 2, the power of Midian prevailed against Israel. Because of Midian, the sons of Israel did what? Where'd they live? They lived in caves. Why? They were afraid. It was protection from them. They could protect themselves in caves. They couldn't do that in other places. Verse 3. For it was when Israel had sown what? Harvested their crops, that the Midianites would come up with whom else? The Amalekites and the sons of the east. Sometimes we miss those. And they would go against them. So they would camp against them and destroy the produce of the earth as far as Gaza and leave no sustenance in Israel, as well as no sheep, ox, or donkey. Now that's pretty depressing. I mean, you do all the work, you harvest all the food, and they come in and they destroy it all. They take your food. You got to have food to live. But they then destroy it. They either destroy it or take it with them. What are you going to do? I mean, that'd get a little old. How long did that go on? 7 years. Well, let's look and see where the Midianites are from. If you see a map of Israel, and this kind of in the middle shows the areas that Gideon will eventually be fighting. But if you look at the map of what we consider Israel, this is the dividing line between Israel and what is modern-day Jordan to the right of the Jordan River. The Midianites are down here, south of Moab, on the southern part of modern-day Jordan. The Amalekites generally were on the southern part of Judah, of the tribe of Judah, though they've been divided into tribes. They generally were down here, though they kind of meandered into several different areas. Why would the Midianites and the Amalekites leave the southern place here and go up north to fight Gideon and the people of Israel? Because that's where the food was. These are the guys that were harvesting the food, that were bringing in the crops that had sown and were bringing in. So that's where they would go and take the food from, and then they destroy everything else. It's a conquest. It's a seizure, so to speak. And that's where everything was taking place. This is desert down here. They don't have anything. They can't grow anything. They do today because Israel has made the desert bloom. At least they can when they want to. It's still mostly desert, but when they need to, they can. It's still desert. So they had to go up here where the people were able to sow the food. We'll see some other maps to give you a little more clarity as to some of the other places that we're talking about. Now, we first see the problem. The problem is the Midianites, the Amalekites, and as well as the people, the sons of the east, which would have been in here. That's the problem. Verse 7, we're going to begin to see our famous cycle that we're used to. It says in verse 1 that they did evil in the sight of the Lord. Verse 7, now it came about when the sons of Israel cried to the Lord on account of the Midianites. So they did evil, and obviously God sold them into their enemies. Now they're crying out to the Lord. Who did the Lord send? A prophet. What do we know about this prophet? Yeah, nothing except what it says in these verses. The sons of Israel, a prophet was sent to the sons of Israel, and he said to them, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, it is I who brought you up from Egypt and brought you out from the house, of slavery. I delivered you from the hands of the Egyptians and from the hands of all your oppressors and dispossessed them before you, and gave you their land. And I said to you, I am the Lord your God. You shall not fear the gods of the Amorites in whose land you live. How did they respond to that? They did not obey me. You did not obey me, is what he says. Now, do we find ourselves doing that? We see what God has done. We see what God can do. We read our journals and remember the amazing things he did. I mean, last week, I may have had a cold for most of last week, but I will never forget that for 8 hours, God absolutely healed me. I mean, to tell you, Thursday night and Friday night, I was so miserable. I had to sit like this because my nose was running so bad. How would I have ever taught if I was like that and God healed me? So that is going to be the greatest memory. And even that I wrote it down. I don't journal very much, but I did journal that because I don't want to forget things like that. God wants us to remember what he does and what he has done so that when we need that reassurance in our lives, it's there. And we can go, oh, yeah, God, you did that for me here. Or you did that for them here or for her here. You can do it again, or you can do even better. We've got to remember. But then when we remember, when people remind us, what's our responsibility then? To obey, to do something about it. They didn't. So because of that, apparently, we don't learn much about the prophet because they didn't listen to the prophet. They didn't change. But God in his mercy and his love, does he give up on his people? Never. God is long-suffering. He's long-suffering for the Jews throughout the whole Old Testament and even to today, and he's long-suffering for us. Do you know what long-suffering means?
Mercy.
What? Forbearance. Forbearance. In the Greek, it's the word for long nose. Now, isn't that a riot? Long nose. But when you think about it, when something comes up, we should stop and take in a deep breath and just stop and be patient. And that's what God does with us. The long nose is the idea of a deep breath of patience. That's God's long suffering for us. Let's look at verse 11. Now, it says in verse 11, then who came? The angel of the Lord. Who is the angel of the Lord? Have we seen this angel before? Yes, we have. Who is it? Raise your hand. It's Jesus. How do we know it's Jesus? You told us last time.
Because the angel of the Lord is Jesus, and angel of the Lord is not.
Okay, the angel of the Lord is Jesus, and angel of the Lord is not. When we do a study, as she said, on the angel of the Lord, what you see is that throughout the study, if it's the angel of the Lord, oftentimes it'll be interchanged with the Lord. And that's why you know it's not just an angel. It's God incarnate. It's Christ incarnate. Because God never speaks to people. Well, God, no one has ever seen God face to face. And we'll talk about that in a minute. But the point is they have seen, will see Christ in the future. So this is the pre-incarnate Christ appearing to people in the Old Testament. And it says the angel of the Lord came and sat under the oak that is in Ophrah, which belongs to Joash, the Abiezrite, and as his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress in order to save it from the Midianites. Well, let's look up here. We see Gideon here. Now, Deborah is just above him. We know last week that Deborah and Barak fought in a battle in the Jezreel Valley, which is really from this arrow here all the way down here. So Deborah was on the northwest side of the Jezreel Valley when she and Barak fought, when he fought, and she was with him, Sisera and the army. Gideon's on the east side of the Jezreel Valley. So he's from a city called Ophrah. You don't see it here, but I'll show it to you on another map. It's very close to where the end of that arrow is. He is on the east side of the valley. Remember, the valley itself is about the size of a triangle. It's 15 miles every direction. And so Gideon's on the east side. Deborah was on the west side. Right here you see Ophrah, which shows, see, here's the Jezreel Valley, the southern border of the Jezreel Valley. And Ophrah is just on the eastern edge of it. We're going to see some of the other places mentioned, the Spring of Herod, Hill of Moreh. By the way, I've never taken a group to that site before, even though I've been there. But we're going to, this next coming year, we're going to go to the site of the Spring of Herod and see what that's like and get the feel of what happened with Gideon. So this gives you some topography, gives you an idea of the land that they were dealing with. Now it says here that Joash, Gideon's father, was an Abiezrite. What does that mean? Because later it tells us in verse 15 that he's from the tribe of Manasseh. Whatever his name is, was a descendant of Manasseh according to Joshua 17:2. So all this is saying is that Joash was a descendant of Abiezrite, who was a descendant of Manasseh, okay? That's all it means when it calls him that. It specifically probably gives him a location as to where he was in the tribe of Manasseh as he's identifying with one of the sons of Manasseh. What was Gideon doing when the angel of the Lord appeared to him? Okay, he's beating out wheat. That's a normal thing to do. It's harvest time. He's beating out wheat. Is he beating it out where they normally do, up on the top of the hill where you take the wheat and you throw the chaff up in the, you throw it up in the air and the chaff blows away?
No.
Where is he beating it out? A wine press. By the way, this is wine country, even today, up in Israel. So it's not surprising that there would be wine presses up there. Why would you beat wheat in a wine press?
He's trying to protect it.
He's trying to protect it. One thing is he's afraid. Number two is he's trying to protect the wheat because they wouldn't think you'd find wheat in a wine press. And number three, a wine press probably hid him a little bit from the Midianites when they came. That's good. She says this gives an idea that he's resourceful. We see some strategy here, you know, that we will see later when he uses some unique strategy. So he is, and God sees in him the ability to do some unique things, whatever is necessary to protect themselves. But there's also a little, perhaps some fear, perhaps some strategy involved. Verse 12, the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said, what? The Lord is with you. Now, Linda mentioned that. God is with us. He's in the midst of turmoil. 7 years they've been in turmoil, and God is with them, but he's specifically with him. What did he call this guy who's afraid, beaten out wheat in the wine press?
A valiant warrior.
Do you think that he has ever been in a war before? Probably not. Probably not. He's a farmer. He's beating out the wheat. And God sees him as a valiant warrior. What do you suppose God sees you as? Have you ever thought about that? I mean, I wouldn't have seen as, certainly when I was younger, I really wouldn't have seen myself doing what I'm doing today. Because I enjoyed partying, and I enjoyed having fun, and I still do enjoy having fun, just in a different way. But I kind of had a different, same value system in general, but I had different priorities in life. I would never have seen me doing what I'm doing today. I've told you the story before that when we got married, a friend of my parents said, we'd like to give her a family Bible with a sterling silver cover on it for the wedding. And Mom, but asked Debbie first, and I said, are you kidding? What would I do with a Bible? Showed a little difference in priorities. But God clearly saw something else when he drew me to himself 4 years later. Because my name's Deborah, Busy Bee. God knew that. I think God called my parents to call me that because it's so appropriate. How about you, though? What is there in your life that you don't see in yourself, but that God has been maybe raising up in you? He's been maybe calling you to something, even though you don't feel equipped for it. Or you don't feel like you can do it because everybody else or somebody else would be better. You see, when God called Ezekiel, when God called Moses, when God called Gideon, he equipped them. Because he says in verse 16, surely I will be with you, and you shall defeat Midian as one man. Do you think when God calls us, he's going to leave us to our own resources? Now, we'll generally try and use our own resources to get what we think God wants us to do, as Moses did when he killed the man. But God is going to be with us. Whom God calls, he equips. So God's, when he first calls him a valiant warrior. He doesn't call him a scared little guy in a wine press. Or he doesn't say, gee, you know, you're really being wise in there doing the strategic thing. He sees him for who he can be. Do you plant that into people? Now, there's a spiritual gift of exhortation, which sees people at their best and plants in them positive things. And I say, I don't mean manipulate. I mean, it's like me seeing someone and saying, boy, you are really good with people. You really care about them. You have such a spirit of service for them. You know, it's encouraging them with what you see in them. Do you do that? Unfortunately, most of the time, when we look at people, what do we see? The what?
The world.
the worst. When we first meet people, we make an immediate assumption. We come up with a judgment call right away. It takes about 12 seconds for us to make a judgment call on what we think of people. But when we look at people, we tend to walk away and we say, we might think, oh, boy, she was a really nice person, but did you hear what she said over here or about this? We tend to focus on the negative. God focuses on the positive. What if we, when we were with people, instead of nagging about what we don't like about people or church or business or politicians or whatever, what if we spoke about the positives? What do you think that would do for them? What do you think that would do for their attitude and their character and what God had planned for them? It would? Yeah. It would help them to change. It would help them to start seeing the bright side instead of the negative. Build them up. Encourage them. I'm a realist. I'm one of those people, I just need the facts. I'm just a realist, you know. Well, it's going to snow. Okay, we go to the grocery store, we get ready, we do everything we have. I'm a realist at everything. So I approach things as a realist. Now, it's taken me a long time to learn, and my husband finally figured it out after 20 or 25 years of marriage, that a realist is a pessimist. Now, I'm very much an optimist, but when I'm a realist, I'm a pessimist. For example, I was talking to somebody one time, and they were going to apply for a job. And I said, why are you going to do that? You don't have any skills to meet that job. That is not for you. Well, I mean, I'm a realist. They didn't have the job set that was needed for that. But fortunately, you learn, because they turned around and said to me, well, can't you say something positive about what I'm going to do here? And I realized how negative that was. 6 months ago, a friend said to me, I'm going to apply for a job. I said, really, what is it? And she told me. And I'm telling you, it was the totally wrong skill set for her. Absolutely. She said, I fit perfectly into what they're looking for. And I said, what are they looking for? And she read it, and I thought, no way. But I didn't say it this time. Instead, I said, you know what? If God wants you there, he's going to open that door. And you have such she has great skill set. Just didn't match that. But I didn't tell her that because she was dead set that this is what God wanted to do. So instead, I encouraged her about the positives in her life. And I also encouraged her because I knew she wouldn't get the job, and she didn't. I also encouraged her that that God, if this isn't where he wants you, then perhaps you ought to consider doing something like this. You see the difference? I'm still a realist, but now I approach things from an encouragement side. I look at the positive instead of the realistic, which is negative side. Same scenario. Talented people, just not gifted in those particular jobs. And instead of crushing them by saying you're not gifted here, which of course makes you think you're not gifted in anything, you focus on what they are good at. What if we did that? Do you think that would have a major impact on the world? Let me read you a passage out of Titus, since we're talking about this. In Titus 3, we are given instructions as to what we, as older women, are to do. Now, one of the things that it says is, it's not Titus 3, it's Titus 2, verse 3. Older women likewise are to be reverent in their behavior, not malicious gossips. Why do you suppose God says not malicious gossips? Because as older women, we have a tendency to be malicious gossips. The Greek word for that is diabolos. It's only in Scripture 3 times. And this never talks about men as malicious gossips. It talks about women. Because we women tend to look at the negative instead of the positive. And then as we get older, we use that negative to criticize and to gossip about other people. What if we change that? Are you willing to change it today? Are you willing to see people as God sees them, not as you see them? That's what he did here, and what an impact it's going to have on Gideon. Verse 13, however, when God said, "The Lord is with you, O valiant warrior, did Gideon respond with, "Oh yeah, thank you, God. I know I'm a great warrior. I'm going to go out and do your work." What did he say? Yeah, he says, if, why, where? And verse 15, how? Verse 17, if, doubt everywhere. Gideon said to him, "Oh my Lord, if the Lord is with us, then why then has all this happened to us?" And isn't that where we generally stop? If the Lord is really with us, then why is this happening? Do you get stuck on that? We do, as Christians. Well, I'm a Christian. I'm doing everything I'm supposed to do. How come God allows these bad things to happen to me? Why? So with all we've discussed so far, why is God allowing bad things to happen?
This isn't heaven.
That's a good way of saying it. This isn't heaven. Bad things are going to happen. I mean, things do happen. We live in a sinful world. But he goes on to say, he says, why then has this happened to us? And where are all the miracles which our fathers told us about, saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? Now the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hand of Midian. Ooh, he doesn't sound like he's got a lot of hope. But isn't that true? Where is the God that protected our country 250 years ago? Where is he? Why isn't he doing the things today that he used to do back then? Them?
The question is, does God really care about us?
Uh-huh. Okay, the question is, does God really care about us? And does he?
Sure. Yes.
Of course he does. Of course he does. He didn't forget the Israelites and all the problems that they went through, and he doesn't forget us. The question is, have we forgotten him?
Yeah.
Have we forgotten him? So we really see doubt. It's interesting because one of the things that brings about doubt and fear in our lives is focusing on the past instead of the future. Instead of looking at what can I do or what would God have me do to take care of this situation, it's just focusing on the past. Well, our country's gone to the pot. It literally has gone to pot. But what can we do about it? We can't do anything. It's a mess. I'm just not going to worry about it. Well, what if we think about the future? God, what do you want to do with our country? How can you use me, one person, to make a difference in my neighborhood or my community or my state or my country? What if we thought that and said, God, I'm a willing vessel. Use me wherever you want to use me. I'll go. Just equip me and call me and I'll go. Are you willing to do that? One person can make a difference. In this fall, one person may make a difference when the election times come. But are you willing to look to the positive future instead of the negative past? I love that. A pastor said, we're not in the post-Christian time, we're in the pre-Christian time. Because we can be a part, if we look at it that way, of bringing people to Christ and of changing the world, one person at a time. That's what God would have us do, is focus on what he can do and what the future is and how he wants to use us. Verse 14, the Lord looked at Gideon and said, go in this your strength and deliver Israel from the hand of Midian. Have I not sent you? That's a little overwhelming. You're going to go fight and I'm going to be with you. Okay, what would you do if God said something like that to you? If God gave you an impossible mission impossible, what would you do? Wow. I don't know if you just heard that, but she said she woke up one morning, God said, go preach the gospel to all the nations. She goes, oh, I'm just a little grandmother here in Omaha. What am I going to do? But God, I'll do it. You just do what you're going to do. And a week later, she gets a call from a pastor in Haiti and said, you need to come down here. And she put some women together. They went down there, and they put together 594 gifts. There were over 800 women there, and they kept passing out the gifts, and everybody got one. I mean, is God not great at what he does? How he prepares us with his, I mean, he prepared Gideon here. Gideon wasn't a valiant warrior. He was called first, and then God prepared him and gave him what he needed to take him out on his journey, just like he did for you. That is a great example of God calling and God equipping. It's also a good example because hers was a one-time mission trip. Now, maybe God will do it again. Maybe it's open the doors. Maybe it'll continue. But it wasn't a calling for life. It was a calling for a particular event. So don't think that God's going to, well, God's never called me to do anything. I bet he's called you to do a lot of things. And I bet you've already done it. You just didn't see it as a calling from God. Callings from God can be short-term. They can be long-term. Moses, they were long-term. Gideon, they were really rather short-term, at least as far as going and killing the Midianites was. So, you know, just be willing. God might call you today to do something that he just will be done by next week. We don't know. What does God want from us? A willing heart, an open heart to be obedient and to do what he wants us to do. Be open. Apparently Gideon was open or God would never have spoken to him in the first place. But he shared his doubts. He was not afraid to question God. She used 2 Corinthians 12:9, which says, God is perfected in our God's strength is perfected in our weakness. You know, if Gideon had said, oh, sure, I can go out and do it. I'm a valiant warrior. I've done it a lot of times. I'll just go beat these guys. That would have been Gideon doing it. God called somebody who didn't have that experience, but who God knew would do it with the Lord's power. And he doubted it was okay. I question God. I don't question him so much anymore, but I sure have a lot in my 41 years of walking with him. God, why'd you allow this? Or why is this happening? Or how come you're not answering my prayers? Or are you really God? You know, there's questions we sometimes have to ask with a pure heart with the Lord in order to get him to answer. I've even asked for fleeces before, which I'll tell you about as we get going, which we're going to see in a minute. So God says, verse 14, go in your strength and deliver. He gives him his calling. He prepared him. Now he's giving him his marching orders. His response in verse 15 is, I can't do it. How shall I deliver Israel? Behold, my family is the least in Manasseh, and I'm the youngest in my father's house. I am not equipped. Do you remember what God said to Timothy and to Jeremiah? Don't let your youth hold you back. So for those of you who are young in the class, don't let your youth hold you back. You might think, I can't do it. I'm too young. We need an older, more mature woman to do it. No, we don't. God called men in the Bible from young ages to be his vessels. And he may call you, maybe he already has, to be his vessel for his service. He calls the lowly rather than the mighty. We who've been around for a while sometimes have our own plans on how things should get done. Sometimes the older we get, we know we can't do it, and so God has to do it. But the young, God are more pliable, and God can mold you. Deb brings up a good point here, which we see in chapter 8. All of his brothers were killed. So he's got a reason to be fearful. You know, we don't want to just look at him and think, oh, he was just a scared little guy and he shouldn't have been called by God. He had reasons to be fearful, but he did, as you said, he showed strategy, showed wisdom. So he's no different than us when, you know, our families have been killed in the war and we send our kids over to go to fight. We are very concerned because of the history that's there. So he's afraid. How shall I do it? I'm the youngest. I just don't have the ability. Verse 16, a key verse here that you need to circle if you haven't. The Lord said to him, surely I will be with you, and you shall defeat Midian as one man. God will be with you. Not only is God going to be with him, but God's going to work some amazing miracles through this guy too. Do you believe that God is with you in everything you do? He is. He's with you in everything. He will especially be with you when he calls you. Then he equips you to go do his work of service. Verse 17, so Gideon said to him, well, if now I have found favor in your sight, then show me a sign that is you who speak with me. Well, why do people ask for signs? Yeah, there's doubt. They're just not 100% sure. The nice thing, at least in my life, I find out with a sign is usually I'm not going to ask God for a sign unless I'm really ready to be obedient. I just have to have this a surety that it's really you speaking, God. I mean, that's really it. So he says, please do not depart from me until I come back to you and bring out my offering and lay it before you. By the way, I love the idea. What's he doing? God has appeared to him. He's questioning, he's doubting, and yet what does he bring to God?
An offering.
He's worshiping God. So yes, there's doubt, there's question, but his heart is right with God. And then the angel of the Lord said, I will remain until you return. Then Gideon went in and prepared a young goat and unleavened bread from the ephah of flour. He put the meat in a basket, put the broth in a pot, brought them out to him under the oak, and presented it to them. And the angel of the Lord said, take the meat and the unleavened bread and lay them on this rock and pour out the broth. So he did. Now, that's kind of a weird thing to tell him. Do you think the meat was ready by the time he brought it out to the guy? To the angel of the Lord. I don't want to be flippant here. When he brought the offering out, do you think it was prepared? You say, you're shaking your head. No, Carol. What? Okay, she doesn't think it was prepared yet. I mean, you bring a pot out with broth, you're going to cook it in the broth. Maybe it's already cooked in the broth, but you're going to cook it. It doesn't really give us an indication for sure whether it was cooked or not. That's not important. The importance is he went to get an offering, and he's bringing the offering out. He asked the angel of the Lord to stay, and he said yes. So he does in verse 21, the angel of the Lord put out the end of the staff that was in his hand, touched the meat and the unleavened bread, and fire sprang up from the rock, consumed the meat and the unleavened bread. Then the angel of the Lord vanished from his sight. Now, what a sight that would be. You put the meat out here, and all of a sudden the rock starts on fire. Have you ever seen a rock burn?
No.
No, rocks don't burn. Rocks don't start on fire. Of course, neither do bushes burn like that, but rocks really don't start on fire, but this one did. And then the angel of the Lord vanished. Do you think Gideon got his sign? We know he did, because in verse 22, when Gideon saw that the angel of the Lord had said, alas, O Lord God, for now I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. The Lord said, in peace to you, do not fear, you shall not die. Then Gideon did what?
Built an altar
there to the Lord and named it Jehovah Shalom. The Lord is peace. To this day, it is still in Ophrah of the Abizrites. Well, we'll look for it when we go there. But my guess is it's not there today, necessarily. At least we wouldn't recognize it. But when the author wrote this, it was still there. So Gideon obviously recognized this as a sign from God because he worshiped God. He built an altar. Interesting, before he built the altar, though, what did he think was going to happen to him?
He's going to die.
Why would he die?
Yeah,
because nobody can see God face to face without dying. Let's look at Exodus 33. Yep, Exodus 33:20. Thank you. Here it says about Moses, when he wanted to see God, God said, you cannot see my face, for no man can see me and live. Gideon recognized that he had seen God, and he was afraid he was going to die. That's another reason, by the way, we know that even though this is God, because he's called Lord, he's not God the Father, which means it has to be another aspect of the Trinity, which is either Jesus or the Holy Spirit. And since nobody sees the Holy Spirit, we have to assume it was Jesus, the pre-incarnate Christ. What a testimony. This guy went from being afraid, helping out his family, but he was doing what he had to do to take care of his family as the youngest, to seeing God calling in his life and seeing a miracle of the Lord. Now he's worshiping God. He's built the altar and he's worshiping God. What does this tell you about Gideon? Do you see a correlation in his life with your life, for example? How did God call you to himself? Did he do a miracle to draw you to him? Was it just the miracle of the presence of the Lord drawing you when you received Christ as your Lord and Savior? And then you worshiped him? Maybe not by building a burnt offering, but you worshiped him? Let's move on to verse 25. This is the Jezreel Valley again that we talked about last week, this triangular type of a place. Deborah's meeting was up and long in here. This is down here is where Gideon will be doing some fighting. That's where he lives. That's where the fighting will start, but it will move on. Now, the same night, the Lord said to Gideon, take your father's bull and the second bull, 7 years old, and pull down what? The altar of Baal. What is Baal? He's a false god, the false god of the Canaanites, which belongs to your father, and cut down the Asherah that is beside it. What's the Asherah? Okay, that's actually the mother of Baal. Now, see, this was something new to me this week, because I always thought Asherah and Astoreth were the same thing, that they were the female wife kind of Baal. I didn't realize one was the mother. Asherah is the mother, and Ashtaroth is the wife. And build an altar to the Lord your God on top of this stronghold in an orderly manner, and take a second bull and offer a burnt offering with the wood of the Asherah, which you have cut down. As soon as God calls him, does he say, oh, it's just going to be a bed of roses now. Just enjoy life, and I'm going to take care of everything. He puts him to the test. Okay, if you have really, and I'm going to make some assumptions here, that Gideon committed his life to God at this point when God spoke to him and he had the burnt offering. We don't know that, but, you know, in our language, we'll say he got saved. Okay, I'm making an assumption here, but assuming it. So God says, okay, if you really are, then I want to see it in your life. I want to see it change. I want you to see you being willing to do something about it. Why would God say to tear down the Baal and the Asherah? Why would he tell him to do that? Okay, because the first commandment, thou shalt have no other gods before me. The second commandment, you won't make for yourself graven images. They have disobeyed the first two commandments that God gave them. And God said, I won't tolerate it. She mentioned, which we haven't seen yet, that this is in Gideon's backyard, literally his backyard. And the most important thing that she mentioned is that you cannot serve two masters. Gideon, you and the people have to make a decision. Are you going to serve God or are you going to serve Baal? That's actually a question that came up with Elijah. God is saying this needs to come down because you must obey God. You must get rid of these false idols because otherwise the people are going to go back and serve them and not me. We read in our homework in Leviticus. We didn't read the passage in Deuteronomy, but it's there in Deuteronomy 28 and 29. The blessings and the cursings. These are the blessings that I'm going to give you if you will obey me. These are the curses if you turn away from me, and specifically if you follow other gods. These are the curses that will come upon you depending on the choice that you make. So God is helping them. It's much easier not to worship a false god if there's no false god for them to worship. But Gideon's put right in the middle of this because he's the one that has to tear it down. Now, this is not going to be a happy thing. It's like going down and destroying the Nebraska football stadium. How do you suppose Nebraskans would take to that? Not well at all. And I'm just using that as an example because football does sometimes become our god. Now, this is an example or a picture of the Jezreel Valley from the east. You saw it from the northwest over by Mount Tabor. And here you see, again, it's flat land with some hills around. It's a great valley. And today there's houses in here and it's also cultivated, which it wasn't at that time. Also want to show you some examples of a Baal god. This is the Baal god. Just, you know, shows his... He's got a stick in his hand, which some say is an Asherah pole, but an example of a Baal god. And this is Ashtaroth, which is his wife. Interesting picture. And this then would be the totem pole idea. See, the Asherah was like a totem pole. It was a piece of wood. It was a tree that was carved out to look like a god, and we would see that today as a totem pole. There's other pictures of Asheroth, but I think really that's more of a Diana, the fertility goddess, because it has multiple chests and the idea of fertility and that kind of thing. But some people say that that's maybe what Asherah looks like too. So they found numerous. When you go to the Israeli Museum, for example, you can see in other places, you can see all kinds of little gods and big gods and goddesses that they have found uncovered because people worshiped them even when they were torn down. Verse 27. So Gideon took the men of his servants and did as the Lord had spoken to them. But because he was afraid of his father's household and who else? The men of the city. How did he do it? By night. He wanted to do it in darkness. Well, I think that would be very easy to happen in one night. I mean, you've got 12 hours of darkness. Tearing down an Asherah pole with the right equipment wouldn't be a big deal. Sure. All you have to do, he's got a bunch of guys with him. They can put the stones across it and kill the bull and put them on top of there. It'd be a busy night, but I think they could do it, yes. And they would have to do it in one night because if they didn't, they'd probably never have the opportunity to do the sacrifice. The people would have been in an uproar. The people would have noticed the very next day that the pole wasn't there. My guess is they would get up in the morning and just kind of look to the pole. It was always on a high place, by the way, so that they could see it. Let me answer her question by asking you. It says he was afraid of his father's household and the men of the city. Why was he afraid of them? Because they were worshiping on these altars and they would not be happy that it was torn down. So with that, that's why he was afraid of them. But what does this show about him? Was he really not fully trusting in God? Yeah, that's a good way of saying it. His faith was demonstrated not by his fearfulness, his obedience. How many times has God called you to do something that you were scared to death to do? Lots of times. I mean, God told me to go reconcile with somebody once, and I was scared to death to do it. Several times. And every time it was really tough and it was really humbling when I had to do it. God called me to share the gospel with people before, and it was kind of like, God, how am I going to do this? But I just said, I'm your vessel, and by the time I got there, I could do it. So fear sometimes accompanies us when God calls us to do it, but our obedience proves our faith.
Well, I think the other thing that's going on is, where's the most difficult battle? It's with your family.
That's a good point. Where's our most difficult battle? It's oftentimes with our families, and he's going to experience that with his family. Okay, courage is not the absence of fear, but that something is more important than fear. The fact that he obeyed, even though he was afraid, is huge. He did not let fear overcome him. He was faithful in spite of his fear. Well, when he tore down the Asherah and the Baal, how did the people respond in verse 28? They were not happy. The men of the city arose early in the morning. Behold, the altar of Baal was torn down. The Asherah, which was beside it, was cut down. And the second bull was offered on the altar which had been built. They said to one another, who did this thing? And when they searched about and inquired, looks like Gideon couldn't keep it secret, huh? They found out that Gideon, the son of Joash, did this thing. And the men of the city said to Joash, do what? Bring out your son. We're going to kill him, that he may die because he has done this. You know, in life, well, I find oftentimes in our relationship with Christ, we have awesome times of receiving Christ as our Lord and Savior or something, but then shortly thereafter, you have what's called death of a vision. That's an old statement that was penned, I think, by Bill Gothard, which is, you know God's working, you know God's called you to do something, but then it just kind of all crumbles after you've done it, and you don't see things going the way you thought they were going to go. I mean, you're called to be a valiant warrior, you're called to go out and destroy the Midianites. You did what God wanted you to do, and now the people are going to kill you. You're not going to be able to do any of that. That's a little disheartening. You start wondering, where are you, God, in this? That's a good point. Shows the hypocrisy of the people. They cried out to God looking for a savior, and now, you know, God sends Gideon to tear down this false altar, and they're mad, and they're going to kill him for it. I mean, look at Abraham, after God called him, a long time after God called him, he told him to kill his son. You look at Moses. God said, you're going to deliver the people from Egypt, and yet Pharaoh kept hardening his heart. The Christian walk is not easy, but whom God calls, he equips. When we run into tough times or death of a vision, that's when we need to trust God. That's right. She said it's like a test to Gideon. It proves him. It prepares him for battle. It also does something else, and that is it separates him from the people. I mean, he's now taken his stand. The Bible says in Romans 10, 9, 10, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So when people come to know the Lord, we should tell. When we do, we should tell other people. We should confess with our mouths. We should also be baptized. That's an outward sign. That separates us from the world. I mean, Christ separates us from the world, but that verbally separates us from the world. I've told you the story, but years ago, 40 years ago, I stood up in an organization when nobody else ever would stand up. I just stood up in my conscience and spoke against a project they were doing. Well, in so doing that, what I did was I separated myself apart from them. What I said is I'm willing to do the right thing, that what I believe is the right thing, and not go along with the crowd. Gideon's saying, by doing this, I'm willing to stand with God, which isn't the popular choice right here, rather than you. Are you willing to take a stand? Are you willing to talk about Jesus Christ? Are you willing for people to know you're a Christian? Do people even know you're a Christian? If you're going to do God's work, people have to see that you're set apart, that you're different. Verse 33. Then all the Midianites, the Amalekites, the sons of the east, assembled themselves, and they crossed over and camped in the valley of Jezreel. Okay, he's had a life transition now after he's... I forgot to verse 31. How did his father respond to his tearing down of the altars? In verses 31 and 32. He really did. It makes you wonder, why does he have this in his backyard when he supported his son by saying, will you contend, talking to the people, will you contend for Baal or will you deliver him? Whoever will plead for him shall be put to death by morning. If he's a god, let him contend for himself because someone has torn down his altar. That's great. Don't you just love it? I mean, a really wise father here. If Baal is so good, then let him do the fighting, not you. Yep, that's a very good point. Who's the first one to follow him when he fights? It's his hometown, his father. His father either knew he was right in advance or certainly supported him after he did it. And isn't that neat? I mean, God is so good because he doesn't leave us out there alone. He gives us somebody who will support us, even if it's only one person at the time. Verse 32, therefore on that day, he named him Jerubbaal, that is, let Baal contend against him because he's torn down his altar. Again, God changed somebody's name to deal with what he, to signify what he was going to be like in the future or what he had done. Verse 33, then all the Midianites we talked about and sons of the east, they came to camp. So now that God has called Gideon, God has equipped Gideon, God has given a sign to Gideon that he requested, God has called Gideon to stand apart from everyone else and tear down the altars, now the enemy comes. Now, see, I love this because God doesn't just say, okay, Debbie, you're going to do this today. He gives some time to prepare us. You had a week. God prepared your heart for something before you got the call. God does that. People say, and I tend to think there's a lot to it, that God shows us women things before he shows it to the husbands. For example, we're going to move, or you might lose your job, or something like that. Because it's harder for us emotionally to take spur of the moment things. We need to be prepared and be in prayer before things happen. And so it kind of sounds like maybe that's what God was doing for you. He's preparing you in advance for what he was going to do. Verse 34 now says, what happened to Gideon? All right, we've talked about that before. The Spirit of the Lord at that time did not indwell. The Spirit of the Lord came upon people and left people. This time, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon. He's empowered by God in a whole new way. And it says, when that happened, what did he do? He blew a trumpet. All right, I'm ready. We're going to lead people to battle. Okay, the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. He blew a trumpet. And the Abizrites were called together to follow him. And then what else did he do? He sent out from the tribe of Manasseh, as well as messengers to Asher, Zebulun, and Naphtali. Now, we're getting ahead of ourselves. Let me go back to show you the map here. All right. We see the tribes. Asher is on the top left where Othniel is mentioned. We see Zebulun to the right. We see Manasseh here, and Manasseh up there in the northeast are parts of Manasseh. So he's, and Naphtali, which is, I've mentioned that. Asher, Naphtali, Manasseh up at the top, Manasseh here also. He has called to follow, and Zebulun. You know, I kind of thought it was interesting. Why didn't he call Issachar? Issachar is the only tribe in that region that he didn't call. Do we know why? No, we don't see it right now anyway. Then Gideon said to God, if, everything he's been through, he's questioning, if you will deliver Israel through me, as you have spoken, I need another sign. This one he calls a fleece. That's why, this is why we say when we need a sign from God, we're asking God for a fleece. So this fleece, he says, I'm going to put a fleece of wood on the threshing floor. If there is dew on the fleece only, and the ground is dry, then I know that you will deliver Israel through me, have I spoken. And it happened. The fleece was wet. He wrung it out. It was soaked with water, but the ground was dry. Well, I'm sure Gideon thought like I thought, which is, well, that was a stupid test. You know, maybe the ground was dry because the fleece soaked up all the moisture and it just didn't get through to the ground. So maybe it really wasn't a miracle. You ever get those kinds of things? So verse 39, don't let your anger burn against me that I may ask once more. Please let me make a test one more time with the fleece. Now let the fleece be dry only and let the ground around it be full of dew. That makes more sense. Okay, then you really do know it's a miracle. What did God say in verse 40? What did he do?
He did it.
He responded. Now, did God say, oh, I'm sick and tired of you asking me for signs? In the New Testament, Jesus said you call for a sign, but you don't listen to him. Gideon called for signs, but he listened to them. You know, I can't blame him. Have you ever asked for a fleece from God? You haven't?
Yes.
Okay, wow. I haven't often, but I have. The one time I asked for a fleece, my son believed he needed to switch schools, and I was dead set against it. And I just said, God, I just cannot believe this is your will. But so I need to know. And in order for me to know, you got to do this and this and this and this and this. I think there were five things. And they were really unique things. I mean, you need to give them, we need to get a carpool situation set up in the school that we didn't know anybody. And we need to have X number. All these things need to happen. In less than a week, all five of them happened. Now, I look back 15 years later or however long, and I have no idea why God sent him to that school, because it was not a positive experience for the short period of time that he was there. At least I don't see it as one. I think I need to ask him why he thinks God sent him there. But it was clear to me, if God answers all five of these, I need to let him at least experience it and see what he's doing. Sometimes we need it because we just aren't sure. So we need to know from God that this is the direction that he wants us to go. What happens if we expect signs from God all the time? We can get what?
You can get fleeced.
We can get fleeced, okay. Now see, as our faith strengthens, God wants us to trust in him. But there are times when we doubt and we just need to see God's hand in it. There was another time when I said, God, I need to know where you want me to go. My life transition, I need direction from you. I didn't ask for a fleece. I didn't throw a fleece out, but I said, I need direction from you. I was 1 o'clock in the morning. Told you this before, at 9 o'clock the next morning, I got a call from somebody offering me a free trip to Israel with a whole group of people that were, a small group, you know, 26 people that were going from around the world at a time when other people weren't going. Well, this is before I had been to Israel. This would have been my second trip to Israel. So this is way back when. That was a sign to me that God had something he wanted me to do. So sometimes we just say, God, show me. And he does it in amazing ways. Sometimes, though, we throw out a fleece. Oh, that's good. It helps Gideon see this is really of God and Satan's not involved. It also helps his followers see God working. Yeah, well, that's absolutely right. We live by faith, not by sight. We should trust God and look to him for wisdom in his word. And we should. But sometimes my faith has been weak and I've needed to ask God. Not often, but sometimes I need to see God work. And that just, it's because we're human. As Linda said, we're human. It's, she said, it, you know, we're human. It's okay to go with God with doubts and questions. I mean, when somebody dies, we mourn. We're sad. The Bible says we're supposed to be joyful. But you know, when somebody dies, we're not joyful. We're sad. Well, there's a time to be sad and a time to be mournful. And there's a time to be joyful. We go through stuff in life. And we just need every bit of God's compassion and passion and grace to get through every bit of those times. Okay, well, chapter 7, we're going to run through this. Because really the theme here is the battle is the Lord's. In the David and Goliath story of 1 Samuel 17 and verse 47, it says, it's not by sword and spirit, for the battle is the Lord's. And boy, are we going to see this here, because it says, now Gideon, Jerubbaal, and all the people who were with him rose early, and they camped outside the spring of Herod, and the camp of Midian was at the north side. So this is where they were. They were right here, that eastern part of the Jezreel Valley. The Lord said to Gideon, the people who are with you are too many. Too many. How many people did he accumulate according to verse 3? 20,000 people. And it says, 22,000 people returned after they said, he said, whoever's afraid and trembling, leave. 22,000 left and 10,000 remain. So we had 32,000 people. God says that's too many. Why is that too many according to verse 2? Yeah, they're going to think they did it in their power. I want them to see that it's my power. Well, what difference does it make? Is that a little arrogant of God?
No.
And you see God working and doing miracles, and your eyes are open in a lot different way than 22,000 people. Now, trust me, you know, the thing about my cold last week is if I had gotten well on Thursday and stayed well, I wouldn't have been sure that that was God. I would have just thought, well, maybe it was just a short cold. But the fact that I had a miserable cold, was fine for 8 hours, and then was miserable again, tells me that was God's hand. So, you know, sometimes we need to see that to know that God's really doing it. So God said, no, 32,000 is too many. So they got 10,000, verse 5. So he brought the people down to the water because 10,000 was too many. And the Lord said to Gideon, you shall separate everyone who laps the water with his tongue as a dog laps, as well as everyone who kneels to drink. Now the number of those who lapped, putting their hands to their mouth, was 300. And the rest of the people knelt to drink water. Why do you suppose he used that particular analogy of lapping versus kneeling? Uh-huh. Very well could be because two things. The idea of bowing down, and the other idea is when you bow down to drink, you're not aware of your surroundings. So they would not be as cautious. Whereas the ones who took the water like this, you know, they can lap to drink. Well, this is the spring of Herod. We have been there before. It was completely dry when we were there. I hope there's water in it when we go. It's a very small area, but it just comes right out of the rock. The water just comes right underneath the rock, and it flows, as you can see, into an area down here. And this is it. It flows from that rock down into this area here, but depending on the time of the year, it can be completely dry. This is the area that's mentioned in the Bible. So God says, I'm going to deliver you with how many men? 300 men. How do you defeat this huge army with 300 men? Well, only by God. I wonder, because the text doesn't tell us, where do you think Gideon got the idea to use jars and then to put torches in the jars and to have trumpets? Where do you think he got that? Do you think that's in the Art of War book that everybody uses for their war strategy? It's not. I bought my husband one for Christmas. It's not. I mean, it's just so unique. I wonder if this is what God told him to do, or if Gideon... Maybe that's one of the things God saw in Gideon was his creativity. I mean, if you're If you're pounding wheat in a wine press, that's pretty creative. Maybe he saw that in him and he used that and helped him. Anyway, the fact of the matter is, that's what God's going to use. However, before it's time for the battle, is Gideon still a little fearful? Mm-hmm. Apparently, because God says, if you're afraid, I'm going to give you another sign. You see, God understands our hearts. He doesn't look at me and go, Debbie, you shouldn't be afraid. You shouldn't doubt. You shouldn't want fleeces. You shouldn't do that. He says, I understand who you are. I understand where you're at. I'm going to calm your heart. I'm going to prepare you. And he did. Mm-hmm. She said, when we're overwhelmed with our doubts, God wants to meet us where we are. So God gives him another sign. And what is this sign?
A dream.
A dream. Who has the dream? Was it Gideon? A Midianite. So God says, go down to the camp of the Midianites. And when you do, he just said, go down there. So Gideon goes down there. And he heard this dream. It says in verse 13, when Gideon came, behold, a man was relating a dream to his friend. And he said, behold, I had a dream, a loaf of barley. And he goes on to tell the dream. And the friend said, well, that's nothing less than the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel. God has given Midian and all the camp into his hand. Now, wait a minute. If you read the dream, how on earth does the dream relate to Gideon? I mean, the dream is, let's see. Yeah. The dream is verse 13. I had a dream. A loaf of barley bread was tumbling into the camp of Midian. It came to the tent and struck it so that it fell and turned it upside down so that the tent lay flat. Now, how do you interpret that to be Gideon? But clearly the guy had some wisdom of the Lord to interpret this dream, and that's what it meant, and that's what Gideon needed to hear. So, verse 15, when Gideon heard the account of the dream and its interpretation, he did what? First thing he did, bow and worship. His faith is strengthening. Every time he sees God act, every time he obeys God, every time a fleece is given, every time a sign is given, his faith gets stronger. Now, I'm going to tell you, after 41 years of walking with the Lord, I agree with that. It didn't take 41 years for this to happen. But every time I see God work, every time I see a miracle in my life or my friends' lives or your lives or my kids' lives or anybody's lives, that strengthens me. It strengthens my faith. And I'm stronger in my faith today than I've ever been. Doesn't mean tomorrow I won't doubt, but God has me learning to trust in him because of what I've seen him do. And that's where Gideon is. Gideon has that power of the Spirit that is going to give him the ability to go out and fight. And so he went to the people and he told them what in verse 15? Arise, for the Lord has given the camp of Midians into your hands. He worships God. Now you see boldness. Now you're going to see the strategy. Very, very good observation. And that is that in the dream, he talks about the sword of Gideon. Gideon doesn't use a sword. He uses a pitcher and a torch, and it says in trumpets. Verse 16, he divided the 300 men into three companies. He put trumpets and empty pitchers in the hands of all the men with torches inside the pitchers. And he said, look at me and do this. Behold, when I come to the outskirts of the camp, do as I do. So they surrounded the camp in three different camps of 100, 300 guys. He says in verse 18, when I and all who are with me blow the trumpet, then you also blow the trumpets all around the camp and say, what?
For the Lord and for Gideon.
For the Lord and for Gideon. Gideon has apparently built himself a reputation. Mm-hmm. Or let's put it this way. God has built a reputation for Gideon. Because the Midianites knew who he was. And the people know who Gideon is. He was able to amass quite a large army. Do you think Gideon's doing this out of arrogance? For the Lord and for me? I don't see that here. I don't see that. I mean, I see him as a leader saying, you're doing this to follow your leader. I mean, we have our candidates running for president right now. You know, are we worshiping them? I certainly hope not. But we're following them because we believe that hopefully you've picked a candidate or at least you've got an idea of some. You're seeing qualities in them that make a good leader, and you want to follow that. Gideon's the leader, and he's saying, you are following me as the leader that God has equipped. That's right. They feared Gideon. So in verse 19, the victory comes. When did they go down in verse 19? In the middle watch. So it was at nighttime, and, you know, it's about 10 o'clock at night. In the Roman time, there were 4 watches at night. In the pre-Roman times, there were 3 watches of night. They were from 6 to 10, 10 to 2, and 2 to 6 at that time. Later on, they were 4 watches that were divided into 3 hours instead of 4 hours. So it was about 10 o'clock at night. In that time, you know, we'd be up watching TV, but in that time, they were sound asleep. Verse 20, when the three companies blew their trumpets and broke the pitchers, they held the torches in their left hand and the trumpets in their right hand for blowing and cried out, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon." Now, do you love it? A sword. It's no sword. But the people don't know that. Midianites don't. They blew the trumpets. And what happened in verse 22 when they blew the trumpets? They fought against each other, it says. Let me show you a map here. This is where they are up here in this area. And they're fighting against each other. They set the sword of one against another. And even throughout the whole army. And the army fled as far as, Bet Shittah towards Zerath. And then it talks about as far as the edge of Abel Mohalah by Taba. So they're fleeing from up there down here. I love it. If you read about Hezekiah, if you read about Jehoshaphat, God did some of the same things. He routed the armies against each other. If you read some of the miraculous stories of the establishment of Israel as a nation and the War of Independence, God did some of the most amazing things there too. Because even when Israel is not walking with him right now spiritually, he is protecting them as he did in the Old Testament. Good point. First thing they did was blow the trumpets. What would that do? That would wake everybody up. And so people wake up, and all of a sudden, you know, it's pitch black when they wake up, and all of a sudden what happens? There's light everywhere. They break the pitchers, and there's light everywhere. And to them, that must have looked like they were surrounded by thousands and thousands of people. All right, let's get back to this. First, they ran down to here, it tells us. And then the men of Israel were summoned from Naphtali and Asher and Manasseh, and they pursued Midian. Now it's time for the other people to come and pursue the whole army. And Gideon sent messengers out to Ephraim. And so the men of Ephraim came, and in verse 44 it says, they captured the two leaders of Midian, Oreb and Zeb. And what'd they do? They killed them. So Gideon and the people of Israel experience victory. The victory comes at the hands of Gideon, and yet he incorporates the rest of the people into the battle. Why did he do that? Why did he have to do that? Did he have to do that? I don't think he had to. Why would he? That's it. To bring all Israel together under the banner of God at this time and to make them a part of saving their land, a part of what God was doing. It's much easier when you're part of what God's doing to remember it than if you're sitting on the sidelines and you hear the story. So then we come to chapter 6 and we're out of time. Chapter 8 and we're out of time. So let me just take a few minutes here before we run out of time. After the battle, Ephraim gets jealous in verses 1 through 3. Yeah, you're seeing that spiraling down. They're jealous. But the humility that Gideon shows is amazing. And then you have Gideon pursuing his enemies. And you go back to the map that we had, and they're pursuing them all the way over to here, to the Jabbok River and Moab, and even down here to Karkor. Down here, Karkor. Sounds like a familiar name to some of us. Anyway, he's pursuing them. When he does, what do the people of Penuel do? And what do the people of Succoth do? How do they respond to him? They won't give them food, they won't give them sustenance because the Midianites are still alive. You haven't killed them all. What if they come back against us? So they didn't take care of them. But then in verse 12 it says, Zebah and Zalmunna fled. He pursued them, captured the two kings of Midian, and routed their whole army. Then he goes back, and there's consequences to the people of Penuel and Succoth. They had not provided food to them in their process. He killed them all. It says, verse 17, he tore down the Tower of Penuel and killed the men of the city after he had disciplined them with the thorns in the wilderness and the briar. Sound harsh? Yeah, it was a little harsh, but you know what? He was doing God's work, and they were not following God's will for their lives. Now, I want to end here. It talks about the killing of the kings, but I really want to go over to verse 23, because when all this victory is over, what do the people want to do? Make him a king. How does Gideon has said, for the Lord and for Gideon. How does Gideon respond when they want to make him king? Nope. Won't do it. Won't do it. Shows his love for God. But then gets earrings from them, collects gold from them. 350 ounces of gold worth $394,450 as of Tuesday in our market. $394,450. That's a lot of gold. What's he do with this gold? He builds an ephod. So I want to show you just what an ephod is. This is an ephod. This item here, this garment here, not the breastplate that is over the ephod, but that's an ephod that was worn by the high priest. Now, there's different views of it. This is a long kind of a a vest, you might even say. According to the Third Temple Museum, they see it differently. This is the breastplate that goes over the ephod, but they see this as the ephod that comes over the shoulders up here and lines the back and then comes across the front. So it's a little different look depending on where you go, but this is probably more realistic because the Third Temple Museum has the items that really are believed to be more realistic. Basically, it's a garment. Why is he making a gold garment? I don't know. But it signifies a high priest because only the high priest wore it. So it says here that they in verse 27, Gideon made it into an ephod. He placed it in his city, Ophrah. And what happened when he did that? People played the harlot to it. When we go to Greece, and when we go there this fall, we're going to see it. But Greece is 99% Greek Orthodox. What they do is they worship icons there. Pretty much all you can get are as souvenirs are either the Parthenon, which is a goddess, a temple to a god, or these icons of saints that are silver. And they worship them, and they kiss them, and they pray to them. We have this tendency that we need to build something. When we do build something, we tend to worship it. That's why most Protestant churches only have wooden crosses, so that we won't end up worshiping a statue or a saint or an icon or a person or something. But that's what they did here. They worshiped it. When Moses lifted the staff in the wilderness with the snake on it, called a Nehushtan, you know what they started doing? Worshiping it. Instead of worshiping God, they worshiped things, and they worshiped this. It said here in verse 28 that the land was undisturbed for how long? 40 years. And then it says that Gideon had 70 sons. And he mentions a son of a concubine, Abimelech, that we'll see later, which means my father is king. Even though Gideon wouldn't become king, later we'll see that one of his sons wanted to be. Then it says he lived to be a ripe old age in verse 32, and 33 says the cycle started all over again. As soon as Gideon was dead, the sons of Israel played the harlot with the Baals. And they didn't remember the Lord their God who delivered them, nor did they show kindness to the house of Gideon. There's nothing new under the sun. But what you and I can learn from Gideon is how God sees our potential. God calls us. God equips us. God shows us signs. He does miracles. He gives us everything we need to accomplish his work. And he did that with Gideon, who wasn't sure, who was scared, but he apparently had great courage or God wouldn't have called him. God sees who we are and he wants to use us. Are you willing to be used by God? No matter where you are, are you willing to submit yourself completely to him and do whatever he calls you to do? Let's pray. Father, thank you for the life of Gideon, where we see a man who just lived as a man. He lived in tough times. He was afraid because of the experiences he's had in life. He doubted. but you saw his potential. You called him, you equipped him, you used him mightily. You walked a long life with him, you carried him, and then you did miracles through him so that your people would know you. God, how sad it is that they turned back away when Gideon was gone. But Father, all we can do is what you call us to do today. Would you show us what it is you want us to do in life? Whether it's just a short-term thing or a long-term calling, show us where you want us to serve you, Father, and then let us be obedient to do whatever you call us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today on Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank. Living Word Ministries is a listener-supported program. To contact Debbie Blank, you may do so at livingwordministry.org. That's www.livingwordministry.org. Please tune in each week at the same time for Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank.